Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to Future Stars. No Sunday footy show on today because of the rolling coverage that has been over in London, and our thoughts and prayers go out to everybody involved in the terror attacks in London. So let's move on now and welcome the show. It's going to be a massive show. We've got Sean Higgins coming up from the Kangaroos and a young potential top 10 draft pick in young Jack Higgins as well. A couple of Higgins boys on, but we work around the panel, and this man is one of the best looking men in the competition, bar none. But he does have a bit of a clip over the top of his eye at the moment, David Zaharakis.
Thanks for having me, Brownie.
Yeah, How did you get that?
Copped a nice punch to the head last night.
Who was that?
I think Jeremy Cameron missed the ball and, yeah, hit me straight in the head. So, yeah, a few stitches in there.
Very nice work. We'll get into the Bombers game yesterday. Terry Wallace is here, as always.
Yeah, g'day, Brownie. Having a first look at the top 20, always before the championships, a little bit more difficult, but I'm sure Shifter will pick it apart for us.
And a man who's still standing because of our great sponsors at INC Sports Nutrition, Kevin Sheen, who is 170 years old, and those INC Sports Nutrition tablets that you take, they just keep you looking young, man.
They've got me right for June. The month of June is championship month, and Terry alerted to it. We're going to have a real focus on today's show on the under-18 championships, the stars to look for this year, and the stars to have emerged from the past. We'll show some very special vision of those.
You're watching the Future Stars for INC Sports Nutrition, available only at Chemist Warehouse. Let's get into David Zaharakis. It was a good effort yesterday. After last weekend, you couldn't quite get the ball inside 50, but you just kept coming at GWS, who were on top of the ladder, premiership favourites, and he did a pretty good job.
Yeah, obviously playing just that, you want to get start the game well and get off to a good start. And we did that at quarter time. We had the lead. And I think in that second period, they really got on top of us. I think kicked 7-2. But credit to the boys. As you said, we kept coming, kept fighting. We made a game of it in the last quarter. But we just couldn't get over the line in the end, which was disappointing.
Now, your form's turned around. To me, it appears like you're going through the middle of the ground more. Is it more about that, or is it more about that you've got a contract coming up and you need to make sure things are okay with that?
Yeah, it wasn't looking too good early in the season, was it? But yeah, I think just as a whole midfield, we've got a lot more rotation through there. We're getting guys like even Ratio Fantasia and Waller coming through there. And I think it's just a great mix of speed and bigger bodies there now. We're early on in the season. We're probably getting a few too many through there. But now it's a lot more players going through there.
Is he going to be any money left with Joey Danaher doing his contract at the moment?
No, I think Joey's probably going to take it all. I think that $2 million increase in the salary cap might help Joey there.
Clearly, there's a lot of players that go through this situation, and your management deal with most of it, but you've got to deal with your management. Is it difficult? Does it get in the way? How do you sort of play it out?
Yeah, I mean, it's obviously something that just plays out. I think this year, a bit of a unique situation with the CBA getting dealt. And I think a lot of players across the whole competition don't really want to make a decision, or even clubs don't want it, because they don't know what's going to happen in the next years to come. So I think that's all getting to get sorted in the next couple of weeks, and then you can start moving on from there.
You would have been wrapped over the last couple of seasons. You've had some really good young players come to your football club. Andrew McGrath is this year's prototype, and geez, played some fair footy early in his career.
Yeah, young Pidge McGrath is an unbelievable young talent. We play him across half back, and I know a lot of supporters and people in the footy world wanting to play in the midfield, but I think he's a victim of his own talent at the moment. He's playing so well across half back and creates so much drive and run for us that that's why we put him.
Really cool, calm head, hasn't he? He's relaxed as a footballer. It looks like he's probably played 60, 70 games already. It's hard to believe that it's his first year.
Yeah, he is, and he's a relaxed kid. He just wants to get in the footy club and learn, and as every first-year player does, but he's just so, as you said, calm, and he knows how to play footy, and it's through his training.
Speaking of relaxed, cool, calm characters, I wouldn't describe Brendan Goddard to be that way. talk us through this yesterday in the half-time.
Yeah, I was walking in behind him there, and I saw all the pretzels on the ground, and I wondered what went on and saw this vision after the game, so... I mean, everyone knows Brendan's a competitive person, and as I said, that second quarter they kicked 7-2, so he was probably more frustrated at that.
Dyson Heppel gave him a funny look as he walked out. It was just to say, what are you doing?
Yeah, well, he probably wanted to eat the pretzels, that's why.
Well, congratulations to BJ from us. He's been a wonderful player, the 80th player to play 300 games. What an effort. We're to see some vision of him as a 16-year-old when he first came onto the, I suppose, the recruiter's radar. He dominated this championship. He won the best and fairest in Division 1. He did everything. He took those spectacular marks that he's noted for, and he used the ball brilliantly on right and left side, and he became the nominal number one choice for the following year with that performance at under 16 level, as we see him representing Vic Country.
Yeah, he's always been an amazing player, BJ, over many years, especially at St Kilda and also at us. So as you see his vision here, look how young he looks there, the ugly noggin on him there.
That's immediately after being taken number one the next year. And he's one, I think, that really has stood up to that ranking right throughout his career as the best player out of that particular draft pool.
Yeah, nice work, boys. We're over here now at the McCafe with a very special guest. Try McCafe's finest barista-made coffee now at McCafe, McCafe drive-thru. Sean Higgins, thanks for joining us, mate.
Thanks, Brownie.
Big game last night for the first half. Very, very competitive. But after half-time, they certainly put the wheel to the floor, the Tigers, and a few 50-metre penalties, which really cost you.
Yeah, and they were at crucial times, weren't they? Just after half-time. It was an unusual game. We felt like we couldn't get any of our game going in the first half. And you look at the scoreboard, and I think we're 2 points up. So we were competitive in that area, and then really disappointing to start the first 3 or 4 minutes of the third term. And they were able to kick, I think, 3 or 4 goals, skipped away. And after half-time, they were definitely a better side.
Brad Scott's an emotional sort of man. You see him in the box. He gets a bit fired up. He would have been bursting a few blood vessels last night with the 3 50-metre penalties, which all resulted in goals.
Yeah, and like I said, probably more so as well because of the timing of it. When the game was right in the balance, to give away 3 really easy 50-metre penalties that resulted in goal line goals was disappointing.
You guys have been playing great footy, though. I mean, the first 5 games you lost were against good opposition, so you haven't really played a bad game, except for probably 15 minutes last night where Richmond really blew you away. I mean, the rest of the season has been really good for the amount of experience that's gone out of your list.
Yeah, last night was disappointing, as you mentioned, especially that third quarter, but on the whole, I think we'd be pleased with the way we've gone about it. We had a really good build-up into the pre-season. We were confident that our best footy would stack up and that we'd be competitive. And I think we've showed that for the best part of 95% of the season.
You saw firsthand a player you're trying to get to your footy club last night in Dustin Martin. He was extraordinary. 38 touches, kicked a couple of goals. It'd be nice to get him over to the Kangaroos next year, wouldn't it?
Yeah, it would be nice to have a player like that. He was unbelievable last night, to be honest. Just his work in the contest. I think any midfielder that can go forward and kick goals is invaluable. And along with that, he sets up so many goals for others with his strength in the contest, his ability to burst out of packs and to find a teammate.
Is the cheer squad banner there all for it too? Come the North, Dusty, you set that one up?
No, that wasn't my handiwork, but I'm glad we're getting behind that and hopefully that pans out that way.
You do have a war chest to go after these players. Josh Kelly's another one. Do the players have any part in that? Do you come across Dustin's number and say, mate, can you come to the Kangaroos?
Oh, look, I haven't spoken to Dusty at all, but look, we've got full faith in the club in the way that they prepare the list manager strategy and the way they put together the whole list. And look, I was fortunate a few years ago to be given the opportunity to come across as well, so I'd love any player to follow that footstep as well.
You came across to the Kangaroos from the Bulldogs, a pretty successful period at the Bulldogs. Was it a hard decision having a look at what they've done since and obviously won a premiership?
Oh, look, at the time, it was an easy decision for me because I was at that stage in my career where I needed a change and things probably weren't going to plan and the way that I was enjoying my football wasn't at the level that I wanted it to be. And like I said, so much thanks to the North Melbourne Football Club for giving me that opportunity.
Now, you've had a pretty good season this year. It's probably been, along with probably last season, very, very well done, but this is an injury list. I'm going to read this out. This is on a piece of paper. You've had a dislocated elbow, a shoulder reco, an ankle reco, navicular fracture, a right hamstring tear, thyroiditis, adductor, meniscus tear, a groin and a calf. You've missed a hell of a lot of footy.
Yeah, it's not ideal when you read that out, but unfortunately that's part and parcel of football. And you put a lot of work in and, like I said, really disappointing to have setbacks like that, but I think it makes you a better player and a better person for overcoming them and really enjoying my football at the moment, so having a good run.
How do you deal with it mentally? Do you have someone you go to? We've seen, obviously, Alex Fasolo last week, the pressures of football, and it was great that he came out and he sought help. But those injury lists, I mean, you were out of the football for a long, long time. How did you deal with it personally?
Yeah, it's difficult, and you would know as well with long-term injuries with your leg, but The first couple of weeks I think is okay because you have surgery and there's a lot of support from other guys because they know you're injured. But it's that second half of your recovery where you sort of get lost in the wilderness a little bit in terms of the rehab group and you're slugging away by yourself. They're the tough times, but fortunately for me, most of those injuries had a really clear focus to get back in and either be in contention for finals or play finals, and I think that helps. And gave me that carrot at the end to continually push through the rehab process to try and get back as quickly as possible.
More coming up with Sean Higgins later on Future Stars. Plough, a young man you're going to hear a lot of, Will Sutherland. He's going to be a big name coming forward.
Yeah, certainly. There's no doubt that he is, Shifter. And I left him out of my top 20 just because I didn't know where he's at. But what do you think? I mean, he's got a big decision in front of him, and how's he progressing along?
Yeah, I had a look at him yesterday, actually. Scotch College playing Halebury College. A terrific game. He kicked 3 goals. He's a boy of 195 centimetres. He's been announced in the Vic Metro squad, and over the next month we'll probably see him playing the National Championships. That may well help him make his decision on footy or cricket.
Well, I get the sense that he is a potential top 20 brownie. As I said, I left him out because we didn't know what the young man was going to do, so I thought best to leave him out this time around, wait and sort of see whether he goes to the champs, and then we'll consider him at that stage.
A young man named Jackson Ross has got some big decisions. He's a great tennis player. He played at Halebury yesterday. 6'4", athletic type, plays at half forward. Very, very good, skillful player. I spoke to Matthew Lloyd. Couldn't have spoken more highly of this young man. He's a game winner and he's going to be a good player shifter.
Yeah, kicked 3 goals yesterday as well, and a boy that'll mix his footy between Halebury and the Eastern Rangers. And as many boys, they've got to make decisions at some stage about which sport they're going to specialise in. And there he is. He's on the European circuit as a 15-year-old. At one stage wanted to be in the top 10 in the world in tennis, but has decided that the AFL career is the one that he's after. And yesterday showed some real traits of an AFL player.
He was a top 10 junior in tennis, and I was the same going back when I was about 14. I was sponsored by Prince and played a game up in Brisbane and smashed a couple of rackets, abused a player on the other side of the net, and I got a letter from Prince that following week saying we are revoking your sponsorship, so my tennis career ended pretty quickly.
Well, it's not all about you, Brownie. There was a player yesterday who kicked the winning goal, and Zachy, this is something that you've done in the past, isn't it? So, look, fantastic opportunity when it's a tight game, and we're talking about Sam Hayes yesterday, had that opportunity to be the absolute match winner.
Yeah, they happen very few and far between, I can assure you that. And it's great when it happens. We saw David Mundy do it a couple of weeks ago.
Perhaps not as spectacular as yours.
Not as spectacular, not right in front of goal. When you play on from about 45 out, they tend to get the crowd going. But yeah, it's a great achievement to do. And as I said, when you do it, you get to enjoy it.
Yep. How's he looking, Shifter?
I watched that game early yesterday too, and he dominated the ruck, and he's a boy that can push forward. He's the one that made All-Australian last year as a 17-year-old. He's 203 centimetres, that boy. No doubt he'd be the first ruckman taken. Where, we're not too sure.
Well, another one to watch, and that will be high up in my top 20, is Cameron Rayner. Just such a powerful player, Shifter. How are you rating him?
Well, he's a bull. He's got a bit of Dusty Martin about him. The don't argue comes out from time to time. He's got that lovely step through the traffic, the acceleration. He can take it in the air. He's a thump and kick outside 50. He's one of those off the one step can put him through as well. So he looks to me a top 10 player.
Now, Shifty, you've brought in some props today. You've got a big photo there sitting next to you. I've been wondering what this is.
Well, we snuck down to Geelong during the week to make a presentation to Joel Selwood and Paddy Dangerfield, and we did it in the company of some of the academy players that are out there at the Geelong Grammar. So this is the 20 in 20 team, the best 20 players in our national academy in 20 years, and of course those two very prominent in it. But we've got a picture here of the boys. What about this for a couple of hours late in the day? They join Selwood and Dangerfield in the players' lounge, as we look at this picture here, from Simmons Stadium for a couple of hours as they chatted with them just over tea, and they talked to these 16 and 17-year-olds about their careers, their moments back in the under-18 championships, and the likes of Jared Brander, Paddy Dow, Jai Corwell. These boys, Lockie O'Brien, had probably the best couple of hours of their life to date, I would think, in getting a little bit of an insight into what's required to make the grade.
Dangerfield and Selwood, just to get to a chat for the young men, would have been fantastic. Nice work there, Shifty. If you want to talk to us on social media, get on Facebook.com/FutureStarsTV. Ask a question to Sean Higgins. Ask a question to David Zaharakis, Terry Wallace, about his top 20 picks coming up. Sean Higgins is going to join us on the panel next on Future Stars for INC Sports Nutrition. Stick around. Welcome back to Future Stars. Brian C. Sports Nutrition, available only at Chemist Warehouse. We've got Sean Higgins, the best set shot goal kicker in the competition, at the desk with us, mate. Finals are still got to be the agenda. You're only 2 games out, but you've been playing good enough to play against the best sides.
Yeah, I think it's always for players, it's a focus. I don't think you talk about it as a whole group in the situation when we're at. But like we were mentioning before, if we continue to play the brand that we have for most of this year, then we'll put ourselves right in contention. If that's enough to play finals at the end of the year, then great. And if not, well, it's something we can build on.
as someone who's coached, you look at players within sides and go, gee, I wouldn't mind getting a hold of that player. Mason Wood is one of those for me. I see three or four things every week that sort of say this young man could be anything, but the whole jigsaw puzzle is not quite there 100% yet.
Yeah, I think with those key position types, especially up forward, that sometimes they can take a little bit of time to come on. Now, Mason's had some unfortunate injuries over the last couple of years. Last year, he put six really quality games together. This year, probably a little bit indifferent, like you mentioned. A few weeks ago, just took the game apart. Look, the way we moved the football last night didn't help guys like Mason at all. So, unfortunately, couldn't get him into the game. But with finishes like that, his ability to cover the ground, he's as fit as anyone in our team. He's good overhead and he's good finish with goals. So it sounds like they're a complete player. It's just a matter of him doing that consistently.
Another player that's probably going to be a big part of the future of North Melbourne is Trent Dumont. I think he's in his fourth year now. How are you finding his development into more of a midfield role for you blokes going forward?
Yeah, he's been great. He had a really good first half on Trent Cotchin last night, I thought. And he's tough, he's strong body. He's seen the contest really strong over the footy. With Ben Jacobs not in the team at the moment, he's able to do a semi-run with role. He's had a couple of those jobs throughout the year, and just a young midfielder that you can see playing 10 plus years for the footy club, and he started his career really well.
What about the footy factory that has been the Geelong Falcons over the last 20 years? Mickey Turner has put together this list. We're going to bring a board up now of the last 20 years of the Geelong Falcons, and I'll tell you what, it is one hell of a team, Higgo.
It is. It's impressive when you even look at the spine of that side, and a lot of quality names and a lot of captains that have gone through the AFL.
Just couldn't quite get a spot on the ground there.
Mate, I'm happy to find a spot on the bench with a few of those names.
What are your memories of coming through that system?
Yeah, it's obviously really early days when you go into a program like that, and I think I had 2 years in the under-13s, into the 15s, and then just had the 1 year in the under-18s, but it's a big part of your junior life, isn't it, when you make teams like that. And great memories, played with some great players, some of which that were in that team and against some quality players as well.
Now, Sean, you're noted for your skills. Do you credit your old man Mick with, well, I suppose the silky skills that we call your kicking ability and that these days? What the work that he put in with you in your primary school days, maybe? Because let's have a look at you now when you're playing for Vic Country. The number four here, you have got great skills as a youngster. Was your dad a big impact early days?
Oh, look, I'll probably credit him for the hours that I annoyed him, pestered him when he came home from work, that I was waiting out the front for him to kick the footy until it was dark. But first time I've seen this footage, and it was had to dust off the cobwebs because it was the best part of 12 years ago. But a lot of time spent. I think any skillful player, it looks like it just comes naturally, but more times than not, they've put a lot of work in.
It was just about a VHS, that one. That's how old it was. But the other bloke in the game that stood out, I was having a look at this during the week, was a bottom ager by the name of Joel Selwood down at Simmons Stadium doing his stuff. He had 26 disposals in the game. What were your first impressions of a young Joel Selwood?
Yeah, I was fortunate enough to play a fair bit of footy with Joel, even earlier days than this. And the way he goes about his footy now is the way that he went about his footy when he was 15, and you would have seen that as well, the way he was coming through. So,
what about his courage? We had his girlfriend on Triple M footy the other night, and she said that she cringes every time he goes back with the flight. This was 15 minutes before the game, and like 15 minutes into the game, he's doing it. I mean, it must be hard for the partners of guys that have that much courage.
Yeah, it is, and family and parents as well, isn't it? But that was an unbelievable game on Friday night, and to watch the way he goes about it, see it firsthand growing up, to see it firsthand playing against him now, it's a special player.
Big gash. Imagine how tough Zaka looks at the moment with that extraordinary toughness.
Didn't back for this, Brownie.
Well, we are making this a family affair, and your sister's having a kick as well, and I don't know whether we have any brother-sister combinations in the competition, but she's playing in the VFLW with Geelong. How's she going?
Yeah, she's going okay. That's her there, left footer number two for Geelong, but she's playing today. I'll head out and watch her. It's the first game I get to see of her of life. But I think she's enjoying it. She's always loved footy. I was pestering her to kick the footy growing up as well. So that probably improved her skills. And like I said, enjoying it and going well. And hopefully she kicks on.
Do you think she can make it?
Oh, you never know. It's her first year playing in obviously the professional in terms of teams rather than just a little bit of school footy or kicking around. So we'll see how she gets through this year, but from all reports, she started pretty well.
Both of you guys have got some great young forwards who are dominating the competition at the moment. Yourself, you've got Joey Danaher, you've got Ben Brown. He's an amazing athlete, Joey Danaher. He's got his kicking a little bit fixed up at the moment, but he's just an unbelievable player to watch. And you're on the edge of your seat every time. You just want him near the ball.
Yeah, he's an amazing talent, Joey. Like this, you can see how he can take big pack marks. All you do is put the ball up anywhere in his vicinity, and you know he's going to launch for it. And then around the 50-metre mark, if he's anywhere around 50 or 60, he's going to swing around onto that left foot and either spot up a teammate or have a shot from 50 or 60. And the great thing about him is he can kick him. I think against Geelong a couple of weeks ago, he kicked one from 50 on the run on the boundary line and it wins his games of footy.
Is there any point in calling for the handball anywhere near 60 for Joey?
Probably not. There's a bit of Scott Lucas about it. Where he didn't know he had a handball. But yeah, if he kicks him, he kicks him.
Well, Sean, I really like Ben Brown, but Nathan Brown loves Ben Brown. Right. And it's probably more to do with the fact that he usually kicks the first goal of each game than anything else. But he's really progressing along magnificently well.
Yeah, he is. I think anyone at that size, up forward, we spoke about sometimes they take a while to come on, but Brownie was a mature age, got his chance playing for Werribee, lucky enough to be picked up. And I think, unfortunately for us, Wadey missed a little bit of the chunk of the first part of the year, but I think that probably fast-tracked Brownie's development and importance to the team. And on the lead up, he stretches those long arms. There's not many in the competition that can spoil that. And I know he's kicked the first goal a number of times, but even his set shot as well is as good as any big man in the comp.
He's a beast of a man. Mate, thanks very much for joining us on Future Stars. It's been a long morning. Not a great night last night, but hopefully the rest of the year goes smoothly.
Thanks, guys. Thanks for having me.
Still plenty more to come on Future Stars. A young man who's going to be in the top 10 of the draft potentially. We'll see what Terry Wallace has to say about that. He's up next. Jack Higgins is his name. Future Stars, Brian C, Sports Nutrition. Andrew McGrath, welcome, mate. His name's Hugh McCluggage. Welcome to Future Stars, mate. Number one pick. Welcome, mate. And what do you think of yourself making the top 10 of Plough's Phantom Draft?
To be honest, I've just tried to shy away from it and just live in the moment.
Not every day you get to play against AFL players.
Yeah, look, it's a great concept, Bronny, and we've got three boys here with very different backgrounds.
Just having a look at some of the highlights of Jack Bowes, and he sort of just put his head up there. He was very happy with what he was doing on the screen. Fantastic effort.
Thanks, mate.
Welcome back to Future Stars. Brian C, Sports Nutrition, train hard, live large with INC. Now, that were some of the best young players from last year, and I noticed that I said mate a lot, and a lot of players said mate back to me, but this young man, Jack Higgins, plays for the Oakley Chargers. He is going to be, hopefully, in players' top 20, maybe the top 10. We'll find out soon, but welcome to Future Stars.
Thanks for having me.
Mate. Appreciate it. Yeah. you got so many good teammates that you played with last year. I mean, we had a look at Tim Tarana, you got Oliver Flint, Andy McGrath. Yeah. You played with them at the bottom age last year. What did you learn from them, and how exciting is it to see what they're doing right now?
Oh, I learned heaps off them. Brownie, just like learning off them. I stayed in a room with Oliver Flint one night, and just Tarana, his routine and stuff that he goes through. It's just showed me like what I need to do. And also Andy and Tim, they're just doing really well in the AFL. And just hopefully one day I could maybe do that.
Is it good to see them playing right now and know that you play with them, and maybe next year you're going to be doing that? Is it something that you go to bed thinking of it or not? Because I know when I was a young kid, 16, 17, that's all I wanted to do. I went to bed and I dreamed about playing as an AFL player.
Yeah, well, just seeing them playing really well in the AFL gives me confidence, because I played with them last year. Gives me like sort of an insight, but no, I don't really dream about that, Brownie.
Now, last year, as a bottom major, you played in Vic Metro. You won the championship. What was the experience like that, winning as a bottom age kid? You won the championship. And then going forward this year, chance to go back-to-back?
Yeah, well, last year was just a crazy time. We were probably an underrated team last year, and to win it was just so good because everyone sort of underrated us being a team. But, this year, really excited, trying to win the go back-to-back this year. So, yeah, should be good. Can't wait for it.
So what have you learned from last year that you think you can take in to help you for this year?
Just like the tempo. Like going in, because I played school footy last year, was so much of a really step up from school footy to national championship. So I think just playing tack up this year and just going into national champs, yeah.
And just getting back onto you, on your football with Oakley, four goals yesterday. What was your positioning? Are you playing mostly forward at the moment, or how is that sort of there playing itself out?
Yeah, I'm playing mostly forward at the moment, playing like the six or five role, but also I can go a bit deep down forward. Yeah, I'm really enjoying my time down there.
Now, Jack, the igniter with you in terms of your passion for the game, you've got an unbelievable passion and love of the game. Where did that come from?
It's probably my dad and mum. They both love footy, and just all my mates. Just been around them since I was born and stuff like that. So, yeah.
If there's a player that you look up to in the AFL that you'd like to play like, or you model your game on, who is it?
Oh, probably like a bit of like a Robbie Gray down forward. Like a really, and same as Sam Mitchell. Just any small players, because I'm pretty small, so.
Now, Jack, we want to see what you like at the talent ID stuff. Toby Wooler's a teammate of yours, grandson of a famous Geelong name, Fred Wooler, was captain of a premiership side. How's Toby progressing with his footy? We'll see some vision of him here.
Yeah, Toby's playing really well at the moment, kicking a few goals. But what I really like about Toby, he's really unselfish. He likes to pass them off and get his teammates involved. And he's such a good below his feet and really good mark. So, yeah, he's doing really well. Can't wait to see him play in the Nationals.
And another boy at bottom age, Xavier O'Neill, was amongst your best players there yesterday. You tell us a bit about Xavier. We'll see some vision of Xavier.
Yeah, well, Xavier's bottom ager. He probably wasn't expecting to play. I don't think he made the under 16 list last year. But to his credit, man, he's absolutely playing really, really good footy. And can't wait to see him develop even more.
Can't wait to see you develop. Can't wait to see the top 20 draft picks. Player's going to do his top 10 after the break, but right now, 20 to 11. Do you reckon you're going to be in it?
Hopefully. I'm not sure.
Well, we'll get it rolling straight away. And at pick number 20 is Jack Petrocelli from the Northern Knights. He's a goal kicker. He's lightning quick. And some may have him marginally above that, but at 20 at the moment for me. 19 is Lachlan Fogarty, and he's from the Western Jets. A midfielder, a shifter, and playing some really solid football.
You just say creative and courageous. You love to have those two things next to your name. He was a star for the Australian under-18 side against the Northern Blues when they played at Etihad Stadium. Just a ball winner, a boy from St Kevin's of the Western Jets.
Cullen Coleman from Sturt, a key position player, can play ruck as well. Paddy Naish at 17. We've had a look at him.
Had him on the show a couple of weeks ago.
Over the past week, so I've got him at 17 at the moment. The one we're just going to concentrate a little bit here is Matthew Ling, certainly another midfielder from the Geelong Falcons.
Well, you'll see the name there at the Falcons and think, well, that's Cameron's what? Nephew? No relation to Cameron Ling. Surprise. But there's two of them. They're twins. You've got Harrison and Matthew Ling. Matthew is the quick player that you'll see play for Vic Country. He's got that line-breaking speed, very different to Cameron, and that's his special part. You need an X factor. He has got that and has been in super form for the Falcons.
15, Paddy Dow from Bendigo, playing some really good footy and kicking a lot of goals with Brighton. 14, you need good decision-makers, and Joel Garner is exactly that, Zacha.
Yeah, definitely, and he's the first ever Indigenous player to captain Scotch College, so he's obviously got a lot of footy ability and a great decision maker, but he's also a great leader at an elite Melbourne school.
Well, and a good kid too. He's on the show last week. He was a beauty.
Absolutely. 13.
Well, lucky, here we go.
Lucky for some is Jack Higgins. The man sitting next to me can play midfield. Obviously, we know that he can play as a reliable forward as well. Shifter, at 12, I've got Charlie Spargo. Probably one of the smaller players in there, but a heck of a lot of talent.
Just think Boomer Harvey. He's retired. He's the next one coming through. This boy's a playmaker, whether it's the middle of the ground or up forward. He really has an impact. Plays with great zest around the footy.
And at 11, James Worrell from the Geelong Falcons. Another Falcon player in there. The factory is just churning them out, Brownie.
It certainly is. And Jack, one of the great things about being an AFL player, as Zacha would know, you get a lot of free stuff and you get a lot of stuff given to you. And we have the best gift lounge in the business thanks to Chemist Warehouse. You'll go home with a Chemist Warehouse voucher to discover all the new fragrances, CK All from Chemist Warehouse for $39.99. You'll be smelling absolutely beautiful. Totally work with these. King Ju. Urban boots made from only the soft polished leather, $240 a pair, those bad boys are. Night for two at Melbourne's Parkview Hotel in St Kilda Road, close to everything that is Melbourne. A $50 McCafe voucher, head into taste their finest ever barista made coffee. It's an absolute belting coffee. A voucher thanks to Sammy & Co, 447 Chapel Street, South Yarra. Think of how good Zaha Arrakis looks today. That's how good you can look. Around for four, car hire at Club Mandalay. Get involved, clubmandalay.com.au. A still gift voucher thanks to our mates at Still and their awesome new battery powered garden tools. You can do some work around the house. Grab a delicious meal, $100 voucher at Platform 28. It's right across from our wonderful studios here at the Docklands, and a HD Sports Action camera. Thanks to the Telstra store in Thomastown, 69 Dalton Road, out in Thomastown, and this fantastic Dometic Cool Icebox, Dometic Mobile Living Made Easy. Jack Higgins, we wish you all the best. Thanks for joining us on Future Stars. Hopefully, you go a little bit higher in the draft than 13 and you have a great career, mate.
Thanks for having me, guys. Really appreciate it.
Jack Higgins, he is going to be a superstar coming up. Remember that name. Still plenty more to come on Future Stars for INC Sports Nutrition. Welcome back to Future Stars for INC Sports Nutrition. It's been a big show so far. We had Sean Higgins from the North Melbourne Footy Club. We've had David Zaharakis here for the whole time. Plough, just before the break, went through his top 20, 20 to 11 of the draft coming up potential this season. Now he's going to take us through the top 10. Take it away, Plough.
Yeah, well, we go to number 10 straight away. Hunter Clark from Dandenong. Shifter, run and carry player, showing some really good signs.
Well, I think we call him the Rolls-Royce. He's got the Rolls-Royce motor. He can go up a gear when he needs to get away. Uses the ball brilliantly right and left. A great decision-maker with his hand passing as well. Midfield to halfback, I think he's a real special player for the future. Hunts the footy, the Hunter Clark.
And then we go to the Eastern Rangers at pick 9 with Adam Serra, a contested inside midfielder.
Yeah, overcome adversity too. Missed most of last year with a meniscus to the right knee and a prolific ball winner through the midfield. Composed is what you'd like to have next to your name. Makes great decisions as well. And at 186, he's a likely midfielder for AFL down the track.
Zacha at pick 8, Connor Ballardon from the Brisbane Academy.
Yeah, he's an imposing tall forward. He impacts the game by just crashing packs. Taking some good, strong marks and someone that can develop maybe under Stephen Martin in the future.
At pick 7, we've got at the Eastern Rangers, Sam Hayes. We saw a lot of him last year and we've spoken about him in the past. I really like Lockie O'Brien from Bendigo, obviously playing school footy as well. At pick number 6, I'm waiting to sort of see the championships to see how he progresses. Pick 5, Shifter, Jaden Stevenson from the Eastern Rangers again. A very good decision maker.
And he's got the Inspector Gadget arms. He just takes those big marks on the lead-up forward. About 188, lead-up forward. Terrific through the midfield yesterday when I watched him playing on the wing as well. So quick as a flash and is a boy that, as I say, has got a few attributes to his game overall.
We're getting to the top of the tree now, and any of these boys could eventually go number one. Obviously, championship still to play out. Luke Davies-Uniacke is another one shifter and had a pretty fair game yesterday as well.
Yeah, played at Halebury yesterday, had 37 disposals, and in a game where they were behind 3 goals, he lifted them over the line. You love to see that under pressure. A very good player for the Australian under-18 side too against the Northern Blues. A strongly built midfielder.
Well, what looks the best key position player in it at the moment from Bendigo is Jared Brander.
Yeah, I think he's the swing man of this championship, the boy that can play key forward or key back at 195. He's at Geelong Grammar School, a boy from Wentworth, just over the border. The clubs are wrapped. He's in the open draft. He's not part of the Giants Academy, so he's a bonus for the draft. It'll be interesting to see where he plays next weekend when he'll play for the Allies against Vic Country up there in Blacktown.
Well, with him being key position, he could clearly go number one. I've got at number 2, Cameron Rayner. Obviously, we saw a little bit of him shifter earlier on in the program.
An explosive forward and a guy through the midfield with a brilliant step through the traffic. Again, he played well on those games that the MCG and Eddie had earlier in the year. And he's also strong overhead, can get up and take that one-on-one contested mark.
At the moment, the contested footy, being able to win your own ball. I've got Darcy Fogarty at number 1. He's played senior football brownie. So at the moment, I've got him there, but obviously everything will change once we get to championships.
So Darcy Fogarty, you've got to be number 1. 192 centimetres. Is he a midfielder or a forward or a bit of both? Because he's a good size.
Can play a bit of both, but I like his contested ball shifter. I think he goes and wins his own footy.
A little bit of Mark Rusciuto about this fella. Oh, he's a competitive beast in the way he wins the footy one-on-one.
Is there anyone out of that top 20 that Plough hasn't mentioned, shifter, that you can see making a bolter towards the end of the year?
Well, I think maybe Noah Belter might be the bolter. He's a boy that can play key back. Oscar Claverino, another key back. So I think some of those key position players might well come in to top 20 down the track.
Very nice work, Plough. It's now time for the Builders Academy Team of the Year. Build your future with Builders Academy. Visit buildersacademy.com.au. The team remains the same from last week. Looking for a ruckman shifter, and obviously as the year goes on, you can only have one ruckman. We're going to have a look at Lloyd Meek from the Rebels. Now, he doesn't go in, but he's definitely on our watch list.
Yeah, so there's a 19-year-old. He'll play for Vic Country next weekend too in the National Championship. So I think Terry wants to wait to see how the guys go over the next 5 or 6 weeks to see who the leading ruckman is. But this boy's really improved in his 19th year. He can get forward. He's over 200 centimetres and get forward, take a mark, kick goals, and he's certainly very powerful in the contest with his ruck craft.
So here's a board on the Vic Country squad as it sits right now going into the championships. And take us through a couple of those names, Shifter.
Well, we've had Sammy Walsh on the show. He's a boy that returned to play yesterday for the Falcons, in amongst the best as a bottom ager. Myers, a boy that didn't play yesterday. He's the Luke Dalhouse-type small forward. There are a couple of the boys from the Geelong Falcons. They're well represented, as you can see there. Tom McCartan's in that squad. Brother, of course, playing in the AFL and Paddy. So that looks a very strong side. Powerful through the midfield. That's their great strength through the midfield.
Do you remember those days, Zacha, where you were added to a list in the under-18s and you're just hoping that you get a gig in it?
Yeah, those days are a long time ago, but all those boys will be in the anticipation of waiting to try and get selected to play.
And the first round is coming up, Shifter. Here is some of the information surrounding that.
Yeah, so there it is, WA versus SA next Saturday across there in WA, then up to Sydney for the Allies versus Vic Country. It'll be a bye for Vic Metro. The five teams are now in Division 1. And, of course, then the next round of matches is SA, the Allies. And this is where Metro come into it when they play WA over there in Western Australia in their first game.
Plenty more to come on Future Stars. Brian C. Sports Nutrition. Stick around. We've got plenty to go. Welcome back to Future Stars, Brian C. Sports Nutrition. Time to have a look at the TAC Cup results over the weekend. In yesterday's games, Eastern Rangers, a one-point win over Sandringham. Gippsland defeated the Geelong Falcons in a close one. Oakley Chargers defeated the Western Jets. Calder Cannons is live at the moment, just getting over the top of the Northern boys. And then we've got a couple of games still to come. Bendigo taking on the Stingrays and the Rebels up against the Murray Bush Rangers, which leaves the ladder in this situation. The Geelong Falcons still on top, but they got beaten yesterday. Oakley Chargers, Murray Bush Rangers and Sandringham Dragons. They're all the regular names. Eastern Rangers, the Gippsland Power, who beat Geelong, just rounding out the top. And down the bottom at number 12 is the Calder Cannons. And Shifter, there's a fair bit going on too. See, Geelong lost yesterday.
Yes, they did. And our home buyers under-18 coach of the year is going to be Lee Brown from the Gippsland Power. Had that upset win over the Geelong Falcons yesterday, which is terrific. Great to see people like Lee Brown. Of course, a couple of hundred league games under his belt going back and, well, nurturing the stars of the future, including Aidan Quigley. We see a little bit of him in action, a boy that has played midfield for Gippsland Power, across half forward as well. Got that lovely step through the traffic, Quigley, and a boy we will see play for Vic Country throughout the year. And Lee Brown, an assistant coach too to Vic Country this year.
Yeah, it's the Home Buyers Under 18 Coach of the Year. Thanks to Home Buyers Centre coaching you to own. It's now time for the INC Elite Performer of the Week. Train hard, live large with INC. And this young man is Adam Garner. He kicked 6 goals yesterday, Shifter.
Yeah, and the last 3 of the match, in fact, and they were beaten. So I reckon it's a great result on the beaten side, isn't it, to kick your 6 goals as a key forward. This game down in Colac, of course, the home of Luke Hodge, the number one draft choice for the Falcons way back in 2001. And Garner's a boy that really has presented terrifically at centre-half forward and full forward for the Falcons this year.
And the Tobin Brothers Young Multicultural Player, they're going to get to you with a question in a minute, Zacha, but over the years, Tobin Brothers has developed experience and expertise in the funeral customs and numerous faiths and cultures and serves a broad spectrum of Melbourne's multicultural community. Biggie Newen's the man that's going to go in, but you played with his brother Gatch Newen. Can you tell us about him?
Yeah, Gatch was on our list last year, and he was a big, tall ruckman, developing type, raw talent. Unfortunately, he's not on the list this year, but hopefully his brother now in the under-16s. Vic Country team, that Vic Country, I think it is. Yep. And yeah,
he super talented though, Gash, wasn't he?
He was super talented. He's very raw. So hopefully his brother can make it in the next couple of years and get onto a list like his brother. But Gatchy was super talented.
We caught up with Biggie Newen during the week at the Roeville Sports Academy, and he was named in the Vic Country under-16 team.
The Roeville Sports Academy has been going for, well, the AFL program has been going for about 4 or 5 years now.
It's an opportunity for boys and girls to come and improve their footy development, their IQ, as well as getting a good education there. Students first and athletes second. So we like to incorporate the values of the school into the program, as well as seeing them develop their footy.
When I first came to the school, my marking wasn't that good. My kicking was pretty average. Making decisions wasn't like the greatest, but and then Boris and Fish helped me throughout the whole way. It's been 3 years now and it's just been a whole lot of fun.
As you know, around this time of the year, there's the national championships coming up, the 16s and 18s. We've got a couple in the 18s and a couple in the 16s Metro, five or six in the initial squad. Vic Country squad's been announced, and we like to recognise achievement here, okay? And Biggie was announced in the squad the other day. So well done, Biggie. Yeah. All the best. Have a go well. Watch out for the Metro boys, bud. I think they got you covered. All right? Good luck. Fantastic story. Obviously, a Sudanese background. And he really enjoys his time here. The other thing good for Biggie is that it's keeping him in school and he's actually learning that, you know, he's got a structured week and be able to, you know, pinpoint everything during the week.
Boris and Fish are like a big fan of schoolwork. Education comes first and they've taught us to become like mature men.
He's one that wants it, and that's one thing that we always say to all our boys that come through the program now, our girls, same thing, is you got to want it. We can see the growth, and it was great that he's made it to the higher level at the 16s at the moment with Vic Country, which is great for him, but he's going to have to continue to play football and be educated along the way.
He's developed in his ruck work, but his natural skill, we've been able to complement that with his game understanding that we're slowly teaching him. So really looking forward to what he can do in the 16th Carnival and beyond.
Welcome back to Future Stars for INC Sports Nutrition. Train hard, live large with INC, available only at Chemist Warehouse. It's been a big, big show. We asked at the start of the show on social media if you had a question for either Sean Higgins or David Zaharakis. And David Marks has emailed and tweeted in, he did both. Is Zach Merritt the best kick in the competition?
Yeah, I mean, he'd be up there. He's one of those players that he sees kicks that not many other players see. You look at our games and there's opportunities just to kick long down the line. He'll pull the kick inside 45 and open up the whole field of play. So he's one of those players, he's not just his kicking is elite, he's his decision-making and he finds targets better than most people out in the field.
I've played with elite kicks who didn't have the decision-making both times, but take us behind the scenes of Zach Merritt, how much work he does in that, because obviously he's a naturally gifted kick, yep. But it doesn't stop there.
Yeah, no, it doesn't stop there at all. He's in on the days off, even the half days, he's there longer than anyone else. So it's no coincidence that the first 3 or 4 years of his career has been this elevated and this elite, and he won the best and fairest last year because he's a kid that works tremendously hard at his game, and that goes along with his natural ability. So you'll see him just keep progressing over the next couple of years.
Thanks for the question for David Marks there. Tom Stewart's a man that's interested me, Shifter. He's not eligible for the Rising Star because he's overage, but it is his first year, and he's gone through the cracks to a 24-year-old to be playing some pretty good footy at Geelong.
He's been super, hasn't he, down back? And he can play on a range of players of different sizes. Now, Matty Scarlett coached him at South Barwon a couple of years back and identified his talent. He then went into the VFL and made the team of the year in the VFL. So every club had a chance to draft him, and the Cats drafted him a bit later on.
Good user off halfback too, Zach, isn't he? You need those users at halfback.
You definitely need them. You need players that can make good decision, have elite skills off halfback.
Thanks very much for joining us today, Zach. Obviously, Shifter Sheen ploughs off to his media commitments at the football. It's been a tough day for everybody involved. Again, our hearts and prayers go out to everybody involved over there in London. Have a great day and join us next week.